I was talking with a couple of friends of ours a week or so ago, and it brought to mind a story that I had heard a long time ago. I want to share the story with you. There was an older couple. They had been married, they had raised their children. They were driving on their way to church. They were driving in the husband's old Ford pickup with a bench seat. And as they come up to a stoplight, there in front of them is another old Ford pickup. But it's got a young couple. And the wife is looking at this couple in front of her, and she notices that the gal is pressed up really close to the driver, and he's got his arm draped around her, and she just kind of gives this sigh, and she kind of looks over at her husband and says, "Do you remember when we used to be like that? You used to keep your arm around me. What happened? Why aren't we like that anymore?" The husband looks at the couple in front of him and then looks over at his wife and says, "I didn't move." Now, while that is a funny story, the reason that was brought to my mind is because, you know, over the last couple weeks, I shared with you last week, I've come to the understanding that our church has been under attack. The enemy has come after individuals in the church to distract, to try and remove from fellowship, to give other priorities. And when I was talking with these friends of mine, you know, I have been, for about a month and a half, I've been in a very dry season. Very dry. Not bad, just dry. I know God still hears my prayers. I know He still speaks to me, both through His Word and through His Spirit. There's no concern. I'm not doubting my walk. I'm not doubting my salvation. It's just been kind of dry. And one of the things that I have learned is that when things get dry, most people throw out their water. Okay? And what I mean by that is when your walk gets dry, typically what ends up happening is you tend to not read your word. You tend to not pray. You tend to not fellowship. You tend to not worship. You tend to get caught up in whatever it is that is distracting you. And while I was talking with this couple, I realized that we have idols. You know, we look at the Old Testament and we think, how in the world could they bow down to an Asherah pole or to Baal? Or how could they sacrifice their children to Molech? How could they do these horrible things? And yet, what is an idol really? Isn't an idol anything that you bow down your heart to? And we all struggle with those. And the point of the story is that God never moves. He has promised us in His Word that we cannot run far enough or fast enough to get away from Him. If you feel like you're far from God, it's not because God has moved. I would hazard an educated guess that maybe there's an idol that has supplanted God on the throne of your life. I know with me, the last couple months have been incredibly busy. We've just had a lot going on. And to be honest with you, I've had to question whether or not my idol is not serving. Am I more concerned about serving, even serving God, than I am about my relationship with Him? Am I willing to forego my quiet time? Am I willing to forego my prayer time in order to serve. Well, okay, so-and-so needs me, so I'm going to have to cut my time short with you, God. You know, you know I'm with you. I got to head out and see whoever. I want to encourage you today. I tend to be an exhorter, okay? The difference between an exhorter and an encourager is if you're in a car accident, the encourager is going to run up to you, they're going to check you, they're going to make sure you're okay, they're going to comfort you. An exhorter is going to measure the distances and figure out why what happened happened, so you can not do it again to avoid it happening in the future. And a lot of times exhorters are looked down as not being compassionate. And because a lot of times I tend to be an exhorter. We come across as uncaring. That's not true at all. I care very much. I don't want whatever it is to happen again. Christy is an encourager. We had a time where we were driving in our truck and our daughter was sitting in the back and she was just sharing with us some difficulties she was having with her friends. Now, girls with friends are different than guys with friends, okay? Because if one of my friends growing up said some of the things that these girls were saying about each other and to each other, I'd have clocked him, and he would have clocked me, and we'd have gone down in the dirt, and we'd have scuffed, and we'd have wrestled, and then we would have got up, and we would have been fine. Until we got home, and our parents saw the mess we'd made. But that's not happening here. And I'm listening to these things. I'm thinking, how in the world could they even say these things to one another? And so I'd listen. We were coming from Stevensville, headed back to our house. And I listened from Stevensville down to about Fowles. We got to about Fowles, and I said, don't be friends with them. I see Joe laughing. The car got very quiet. And now, while I tend to enjoy quiet more than noise, there's a certain quiet that makes me ill at ease. It makes me uncomfortable. And I'm beginning to think, okay, I did something wrong, but I don't know what. And so we got home, and Christian and I went to the bedroom, and I said, okay, what did I do? I'm trying to help her here. I'm trying to fix the problem. And Mom said, or Christy said, no, you didn't. She said she really needed to work this out. She needed to talk about it, and you're telling her to dump her friends. What kind of friends are they? They're not friends. You know? I mean, with the boys, it was easy. They didn't like what the guy said, they left them. They didn't hang around with him. But that doesn't work that way with girls, does it? Does it? Depends. So Christy had to try to, I still don't get it. I understand somehow that what I did was incorrect. That it did not help the situation, did it, Buck? No, not at all. I don't know why it didn't help the situation, but it didn't. I want to encourage you today. Because I'm not an encourager, I'm an exhorter. I'm really trying to phrase things carefully. Okay? I want you to have the best walk with God that you can have. The limit on your walk with God is you. Okay, that's the upper limit. You set that. You get to a certain point and say, I will go this far and no more. We all do it. Okay? We all do it. Unconsciously. We just have this, okay, God, I will come to here with you, but I can't go any further. All right, and we get stubborn and we get resistant and we're comfortable at this measure. But how far does God want us to go? He wants us to finish the race. He wants us to go for the prize. And I want to encourage you today, if you feel like God is far away, if you feel like there's just this space between you and God, I want you to take stock, evaluate what's going on in your life. Even evaluate the good things that are going on in your life. Because, you know, a lot of times we get tripped up by the bad things. But a lot of times the good things hinder us as well, don't they? I want to encourage you, take stock. See what it is that maybe is competing with God on the throne of your life. Check and look and see which things that have caught your attention and pulled you away from the intimacy that you should have with God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Okay. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and open to Luke chapter 16. Bless you. We've been talking about money. And we're still talking about money. I'm going to read this passage again. When I put this message together, I thought this would probably be 1 week. And the further I got into this, the more I felt like we needed to spend more time here. I felt like there's a lot going on here that we read over, we don't see, we don't grasp, we don't understand. We just kind of, now, am I the only one in here? I probably am, so I'm not going to ask for a show of hands. But I'm probably the only one in here that I get to a passage of scripture that I don't really understand, and my brain just kind of goes, until I get to a part I understand. And then it just kicks back in, right? And there's this kind of null void where I see the words, I read the words, I even comprehend the words, but I have no idea what God is trying to tell me here. Why is that here? This passage is one of those. Okay? I have heard messages on particular verses in this passage, but I cannot recall a single message on this passage in its entirety. So I'm going to read this parable, and then we're going to get into it a little bit further than we did last week. Okay, so Scripture says, chapter 16 of Luke, verse 1, "He also said to the disciples," now who is the he there? It's Jesus. Okay, remember chapter 16 was not in the original document. There was no chapter break there. It was a continuation of the previous thought. Okay, so Luke is writing, he says, "He also said to the disciples, there was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was wasting his possessions. And he called him and said to him, 'What is this that I hear about you? Turn in the account of your management, for you can no longer be manager.' And the manager said to himself, 'What shall I do? Since my master is taking the management away from me, I am not strong enough to dig, and I am ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do, so that when I am removed from management, people may receive me into their houses.' So summoning his master's debtors one by one, he said to the first, 'How much do you owe my master?' He said, 100 measures of oil. He said to him, 'Take your bill and sit down quickly and write 50. Then he said to another, 'And how much do you owe?' He said, 100 measures of wheat. He said to him, 'Take your bill and write 80. The master commended the dishonest manager for his shrewdness. For the sons of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than the sons of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous wealth, so that when it fails, they may receive you into the eternal dwellings. One who is faithful in a very little is also faithful in much." You realize that most people that read or that quote that verse only quote that part of the verse. They forget what follows, because that's not all there is to the verse. It's not even all there is to the sentence. It's not all there is to the thought, because there's another side of this. So one who is faithful in a very little is also faithful in much. And one who is dishonest in a very little is also dishonest in much. If then you have not been faithful in the unrighteous wealth, who will entrust you the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in that which is another's, who will give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money." Now, I'm not going to repeat what I said last week. You can go and look on our YouTube page and see what's going on. But there are a couple things that I want to draw out in today's message. The first thing, who did their homework? All right. What was the homework?
A working definition of shrewdness.
A working definition of shrewdness. Boy, I bet a bunch of you just felt like you're back in elementary school. Huh? Homework? What homework? What did we come up with as a working definition of shrewdness? Anybody? Anybody that did the homework?
Astute or sharp in practical matters.
Astute or sharp in practical matters. Anybody come up with something different?
Intelligently clever.
Intelligently clever. Okay. Anyone else? Okay.
Having or showing ability to understand things and to make good judgments.
Excellent. Okay. That's actually the one that we want to stick with because all of the others convey that idea. Okay. Read that again for me, Lori.
Having, showing ability to understand things, to make good judgments.
To make good judgments. The ability to look at something, to look at a situation, and to be able to make a good judgment regarding that situation. Okay? Now, let's look at that in the context of this passage. The master finds out that his manager, the man that's supposed to be looking after his properties, looking after his interests, finds out that he hasn't been doing so. So he calls him in and he pulls a Donald Trump. You're fired. But it's not enough that he just fires him. He tells him he has to settle the accounts first. Finish this part of your job and then you're fired. Now, I don't know about you, but it seems to me that most people in that situation were not going to have any interest in settling accounts, are they? I'm fired. I'm out of here. I'm not doing any more work for you. But that's not what happens, is it? Because the manager, he takes a look at his position now. Whereas he had a very secure position, a very comfortable position, this is now taken away from him, and he's looking at, okay, my physical abilities are lacking. I cannot support myself by digging. I cannot do manual labor. Now keep in mind that this parable is taking place in an agrarian society. Okay? He's talking to and about farmers. Right? So, the context of his story is being applied to people who understand what's going on. And so he says, well, I'm not strong enough to work the land. I can't be a farmer. All right? Now, that right there should kind of let you know that God has a lot of respect for farmers, doesn't he? Because this is a bad thing that this guy can't be a farmer. But he says, I'm too proud to beg. Okay? I'm too proud to beg. What should I do? I know. I'm going to make it such that when I leave this position, when I'm no longer here, they will welcome me into their homes. And so what does he do? He sits down and he starts marking down their debt. Now, without understanding what's going on here, because growing up and for years, I thought he's ripping off the master. Why is he commending him for ripping him off? This guy owed 100 weight. And he said, oh, you only get 50. I'm thinking, man, he's stabbing the master in the back. I'm gonna fix your accounts for you. Well, we need to understand that what he is writing off is the portion that he was keeping for himself, the portion that he was profiting by. Okay? And the idea, very much like the tax collectors of the time, was that there was a measure that was required, and then whatever you could gather above that was yours. Right? Now, there's obviously some finagling going on because the master feels like he's dealing fraudulently. The manager's dealing fraudulently. So when he sits down with the people and he marks them down, what he's marking down is he's getting rid of his profit. He's getting rid of his path. Okay? You know his severance check? He's giving it back to the farmers. That you know, you're going to get 3 months of pay and then you're done. He's giving that back to the farmers. Okay? He's ensuring a good place with them for himself. So he does this and the master commends him for his shrewdness. There's a fly. Now, why is the master commending him? See, the master is not commending him for the things that he did wrong. We need to understand that. I think this is a really cool illustration of salvation. Because when we come to God, we come to Him a mess. We come to Him just like this dishonest manager. The things that God has entrusted into our care, we have misused. Okay? And not just our property and our money, but our bodies, our minds, our mouths. These things that God has blessed us with, our families, our friends, the other people in this world that we may not consider friends, people that we may consider enemies, but God still sent His Son to the cross for. Okay? And we come in, and the master says, okay, you need to give an accounting. And you know, when we stand before God, the other side of the cross, okay, when the blood payment has been paid, He commends us for what we've done. Because all of that other stuff is washed away, right? It's gone. So the master looks at the accounts and he commends the manager for his shrewdness. Okay? What the manager did was he showed good judgment in how he handled the accounts for the master. Now let's look at some things here. Has anybody heard the phrase that Christians are so heavenly minded that they are no earthly good? Have you ever known anyone like that? Don't raise your hands. And don't point. Okay? But it's so common that we know it, right? Oh, Christians are just so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good. Well, in a way, that's kind of a compliment because that's our goal, right? Isn't that what we're supposed to be looking toward? But while we're here, we are supposed to be in this world, not of this world. Okay? So we are still to work in this world. We are still to be a blessing to those around us. But oftentimes, Christians are foolish in the way they deal with the world. Now, I'm going to deviate here for a second because we were talking before the service, and this is actually something a little bit later in the message that I'm going to go to in more depth. If you look down in verse 8, the master commended the dishonest manager for his shrewdness. Okay? And then it says, for the sons of this world. Some of your Bibles might say the sons of this age. Because the idea is not the physical location of earth. It's like the generation, the age, the bracket under which this thing falls. Okay? So he's not talking about all the people, the population. He's talking about all of those that belong to this time period. Okay? He says, for the sons of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than the sons of light. Now, every time I have read that, up until October of last year, I always understood the sons of light to be us, Christians. Anybody else think that when you read this, when I was reading this and I said the sons of light, did you think, oh, that's us? We're the, because we're no longer a part of the dark, we have come into the light. Well, when we were in Israel, we got to go to the Jerusalem Museum. And in the Jerusalem Museum, they have the shrine for the Dead Sea Scrolls. Okay, they have the original Dead Sea Scrolls preserved, and you can go in and you can look at them. And it's set up in this the shape of the building, the top of it looks like the top of a pot, because it's representing the pots where these documents were found. Okay, now these documents, the Dead Sea Scrolls, are a huge boon to us. Because we have to look back at the original manuscripts in order to determine the accuracy and the fallibility of a document. You have to get as close to the original document as possible, And you have to be able to kind of step your way up to where we are now. Okay? And the why this is so significant, 1947, a shepherd boy was down south of Jerusalem, about halfway between Jerusalem and Masada, and he's chasing his goats or his sheep, and he picks up a stone, he chucks it into a cave, and he hears a odd sound. It's kind of like clunk, and it's not like a rock falling into a cave. It sounds like he broke something, you know, like that feeling, that sense you get when you're in the living room, and out in the dining room or out in the kitchen, a dish breaks, and you know something is not normal. Okay. He gets up and he goes in, and in this cave he finds a number of these clay pots. And one of them he'd thrown his rock and it broken. He looks where this clay pot is, and there is this manuscript, this what looks to be leather. And he picks it up and he looks at it, and it's got writing, but he's illiterate, he can't read it. But he's looking at it and he's thinking, hey, this will make good footwear. This will make good sandals for me. So he takes the document and he goes to the leather worker in town and he says, hey, I want you to take this and I want you to make me some new shoes. Well, the leather worker, who is only slightly literate, he looks at this and he understands immediately, okay, this is something significant. I don't know what, but this is not just cured leather. There's writing on here and it's significant. So he takes the leather and he goes to a linguist, a friend of his, who takes a look at it, and he realizes that what he's looking at are a very old extant copy of passages of Jeremiah. Okay? Now, why is this significant to us? Well, they went back to the cave, the kid took them back, and they were able to find a bunch of other things in there, and then in the caves around, they found numerous manuscripts. A lot of them having to deal with scripture, dealing with the Old Testament. As a matter of fact, they found almost the entirety of the Old Testament in these clay pots. But the majority of the clay pots were actually marriage contracts. Okay, the marriage contract, when a man and a wife would be married, there would be stipulations in there as to what she could expect. And if in any way the husband did not meet this was her legal standing. Okay, now why this is significant to us is that this document dates right back to about the time that Jerusalem fell. Okay, and there was a group of people called the Essenes. Have you ever heard of the Essenes? Okay, the Essenes were a devoutly religious group. It is believed that John the Baptist spent some time with them. They were kind of monastery before monasteries. They separated themselves out. They came out from Jerusalem. They had a very strict and ritualized way of living. They were predominantly populated by men. When we saw the Qumran village where these documents were found, there were more baths than there were structures, because they would wash themselves ritually 6, 7, 8 times a day. And their lives were, everything was in its place. And they called themselves the Sons of Light. Now, as a political party, they weren't really political. They were almost anti-political. They were predominantly from the Pharisee group, but they saw what was going on in the politics in Jerusalem and with the temple, and they felt like that the secularism had kind of infiltrated and ruined things. And so they pulled themselves out of the existing structure and they created their own structure. And their belief was that at some point God was going to come back and he was going to gather all of them together. They were going to be this mighty army called the Sons of God, and they were going to wage war on the sons of darkness. The sons of darkness. Now, when we're talking about sons, we're not talking necessarily boy children. It's a generic Greek term for offspring. Okay, so we're talking sons and daughters. Okay, but the understanding was when God came, they were going to stand with God because of their righteousness. the sons of light would then wage war on the sons of darkness, and they'd overthrow them, and they'd rule, and they'd reign. Okay? Not too far off of what we see in Revelation. The thing is, they had very strict requirements as to what was required to be a son of light. Okay? And you had to meet all of these obligations to become a son of light. So when we're talking about this passage, the Essenes are known at this time. Okay? It's a political group, and everybody knows when he says the sons of light, he knows this is a reference to that group of people. Okay? I don't believe that Jesus is actually speaking about us as a church. I think he's kind of maybe holding up a bad comparison, because if you are legalistic in your approach to salvation, and if you are ritualistic in your approach to relationship with God, you kind of fall into this son of light category where you've made more of yourself than God has. Okay? You've kind of appropriated something for yourself that God has not really given you. Because there's only one way to become part of the light, and that's through Jesus Christ. Okay? That's the only way. So, when Jesus is giving this parable, he is speaking about a term that is in general use of the day, is accepted and understood for what it is. All right, so he's saying, for the sons of this world, this age, this time period, are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than the sons of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous wealth, so that when it fails, they may receive you into the eternal dwellings. Does anybody else remember another time where Jesus talks about being shrewd? Yeah. It says that we are to be as innocent as doves and as shrewd as serpents. Okay, this is Matthew chapter 10. Let's flip over there real quick. Matthew chapter 10. Now you guys are going, what? What does all this have to do with money? We'll get there. Stick with me. We're going to get there. Okay. Matthew chapter 10, the opening passage of this, we have the 12 apostles are being named. Okay? And then when they're named, they're called as apostles. Does anybody know what apostle means? Apostle means sent out one, a messenger. It's kind of like the idea. Does anybody remember the town criers? We see them on TV, sometimes in cartoons. They're the guy that comes out and they pull open the edict from the king and they read it out loud for everybody to hear, and then they pound it up on the wall. That's kind of the idea of what's going on here. The apostles are pulled out of the disciples, because how many disciples did Jesus have? Lots. We know at one point he fed 4,000 men plus women and children. And another point, he fed 5,000 men plus women and children. So we know we had a lot of people that followed him to some degree or another. Okay? So when we talk about the 12 disciples, that's really kind of a misnomer. They're misnamed. They're the 12 apostles that out of the disciple, he called these 12 and sent them out to take his word and spread it all over the area. Okay? So he sends them out, and he's kind of giving them some directions. He says, don't go to the Gentiles. Don't go to the Samaritans. Was that because he hated the Gentiles and the Samaritans? No. As a matter of fact, one of the most significant things that we see that Jesus did was he completely annihilated the barrier between the Jews and the Gentiles. When he went into Samaria, a place that walking into would defile him, and he met with a Samaritan woman and talked with her and engaged in discourse, and he presented to her the truth of spiritual things. Okay, so it's not because he doesn't like them, so there has to be another reason. Why does he say don't go into the Gentiles or enter a Samaritan town? Because to the Jew first, and then to the Gentile. Okay? Remember the Syrophoenician woman? She comes to Jesus and she says, I need you to heal my daughter. She's sick. And he says, well, it's not right to feed to the dogs what is for the master's children. Okay? Not that he's calling them dogs, but he's setting an illustration that there's an order to which God has ordained things. But she comes right back and says, yes, but even the dogs get to lick the crumbs that fall to the floor. And seeing her faith, he tells her, go, your daughter is healed. Okay, and he commends her. Okay, this encourages me because I know that God is absolutely righteous and God has a direct path, but it also shows me that God is moved on our behalf. Okay, that God is compassionate. Okay, so he's telling them, don't go to these areas. And then there's this implied yet, and we know that the yet is implied because we have the book of Acts. Okay? So we know that there's other stuff coming. All right? So he says, don't go among the Gentiles or to the Samaritan towns. He says, and proclaim as you go, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse lepers, cast out demons. Can I get 12 volunteers that I can send out to go do this? Would anybody volunteer to go do this? Look at the job requirements again. Heal the sick. Well, you might be able to give them some aspirin, but the next one really sticks you. Raise the dead. Cleanse lepers. Cast out demons. You received without paying. Give without pay. Don't worry about the money. This isn't about the money. There's something much more significant here going on. It says when you go into a town, stay at somebody's house. If they're worthy, let your peace rest on that house. If they're not, let your peace return to you. Either way, you're at peace. Okay? They should not have the ability to rob your peace from you. Says, and he goes down. He says, if anyone will not receive you or listen to your words, which means there are people that won't, we need to understand that. Shake off the dust from your feet when you leave that house or town. Truly I say to you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. And then he carries on. He says, behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Okay? Now, we see this word wise. It's also translated shrewd. But let's take a look at this word innocent, because what Jesus says is there is a balance that is needed here. Okay? He's not saying, you know, be crafty and of ill intent and don't get caught. Okay? Because innocent is not, in our understanding, it's not attributing guilt to something. Okay, it's not attributing guilt to it. Innocent carries with it the idea, the Greek word literally translated means to be free of guile. Well, that helps, doesn't it? Can somebody define for me guile? That's one of those words that we kind of know what it means, but when we try and pin it down, it becomes a little bit more slippery. So I looked up the word. It's used three times in the Bible. Okay? Each time, it's a comparative statement between the life we are supposed to live and the life we have been called from. All right? So, what is guile? Guile is insidious cunning in obtaining a goal. A crafty or artful deception, duplicity. We see this all the time. When you go to buy a house and you read the description of the house and it says a step saver kitchen, what does that mean? Oh. You got a little kitchen. You know, it should be kitchenette. Okay? Step saver, that's because you can't move. You open the fridge, you put it on the counter. You mix it up, you put it on the oven and the stove, and it's a step. That's guile. We're dressing it up to make it look like more than it really is. That's guile. So when Jesus says be innocent, he says be free of that. You don't need to use, Paul kind of addresses this when he's talking to the Corinthians. He says, we didn't come to you with persuasive words. We didn't come to try and trick you into believing anything. Okay? Because what we have to offer you is not based on our ability to convey it to you. It's based on the Spirit's ability to make it real to you. Okay? So, to be shrewd as serpents or wise as serpents, we need to have an understanding of the way things work, right? But we need to not let that encumber us, to not become entangled in that, not to be caught up in that. So let's go back to Luke. We're talking about the sons of this world and the sons of light. When we're looking at this passage, one of the things that we have to do, if you've ever read any commentaries, if you pick up three commentaries, I guarantee you, you're going to get three fairly different understandings of what this passage means. Okay? Now, that's not to say these men are off. That's not to mean, to by any means for me, I'm not calling them wrong. A lot of them are a whole lot smarter than I am. But what we need to be careful of doing is we need to understand who's giving us an opinion about God's Word. Okay, it's a man with man's fallibility giving us an opinion about God's Word. That's what you get every week when you come here. You get my understanding, including my failings, as I try to interpret and render understandable to you God's Word. Okay? That's why I always encourage you, study. Check and make sure that what I'm saying is right. You know, if you find that I got off on something, come talk to me. Okay? Because some things may have happened. One, you may have misunderstood what I said. Two, I may have misunderstood the passage. Okay? I make no bones about being knowledgeable about everything. But I study and look at as many things as I can to get a good understanding of what's going on here. So when we're looking at this comparison between the sons of the world and the sons of light, especially when you look at the sons of light in terms of the Essenes, who have withdrawn themselves from society and cut off all connection with them, and they have no understanding of how to deal with those people. As a matter of fact, they don't want to deal with those people. As far as they're concerned, the only dealings they will ever have with those people is when they kill them. When God comes back and joins with the sons of light, and they go and they expunge the sons of darkness. Okay? So the sons of this world are more shrewd in dealing with this world. It means they understand how things work. Okay? And this unfavorable comparison is not necessarily comparing us to them, but it contains the condition that it might. Okay? Because if we fall into this thing, like the sons of light, where we kind of pull ourselves out and we have this remnant fortress mentality where it's us and them, and we need to not be anything like them, there's a lot of things that come with that that are garbage, and God does not intend. Now, this brings me all the way back to money. Okay? Why is it that most of the churches in America today are struggling with their finances? Very simple. Because most of the Christians in America today are struggling with their finances. Okay? What's our definition of shrewd? Lori, can you read that again for us, please?
Yes. Having or showing ability to understand things and to make good judgments.
Okay? We need to understand the way that money works, and we need to exercise good, sound judgment in how we deal with this. Okay? Now, we're going to get a couple weeks down the road. We're going to get to talking about lots of money, a little bit of money, no money, where should you be? Because it is my personal belief that most Christians cannot, do not deal well with a lot of money. Now, the next passage, we talk about those who are faithful with a little will be faithful with much. Now, the thing that I want to posit to you today, that I want to present to you today, is if you are not faithful with the things that God has blessed you with, the finances that He's poured into your life, the things that He has given you, if you are not faithful in taking care of those things, why would you expect that He would give you more? You know, as Americans, I guarantee you, anybody sitting in this room makes significantly more money than the average income in the entire rest of the world. Okay, I can guarantee it. It's been proven time and time again. Mathematically, economically. Okay, we are an incredibly blessed, wealthy nation. And I think that's one of the biggest flaws in the church today. Okay, we have eliminated so much of the need for God because we can pay for things. We'll buy our way out of it. And buying our way out of it doesn't fix things. How many billions of dollars have been thrown to foreign missions? And yet, today, we are a receiving nation and not a sending nation. We are receiving missionaries from third world countries that a generation ago we were sending missionaries to. And they're seeing America's desperate need for the gospel message. And they're sending missionaries to us. If any of you have read The Heavenly Man, Brother Yun comes to America and he gets to travel around and he gets to speak with some places and he gets to look at some of the incredible buildings that man has made into churches and places of worship. And he spoke to the gentleman that had brought him over and he said, you know, it absolutely amazes me how much you guys can do without God. Okay, so, money. Why is it that in the church today, we tend to be gullible? We tend to either have this hard-hearted attitude where it's ours and nobody can touch it, or we have this completely opposite idea that we don't know how to keep things afloat, so we're throwing good money after bad. Why is it that we cannot discipline ourselves to understand the basic principles of sound financial decisions and apply them at a church level? Now, I'm not saying that all of a sudden, economics becomes our God. Not by any means. We are subject to Him because whose is it anyway? Right. It's His. So when God speaks to us and tells us to do something that is not a sound decision, like, hey son, I need you to give up your lunch so I can feed the rest of the people. We've got to be obedient because we rob God of His due glory when we forbid Him to move because of our misunderstandings and our misapprehensions. Okay? So, let's look at this a little bit more and then we're going to wrap up for today and I'll try and finish this section next week. No, I won't. I won't finish it next week because we're going to be doing the Orange Sunday. I'm not even going to go into the next passage because I there's too much there and I don't want to distract you. One thing that I want to say to you today, okay, is there has been this belief for several decades now, and probably even longer, but it's become prevalent among the church, especially in Pentecostal charismatic churches, where it's almost that faith and intelligence are polar opposites. And if you have intelligence and you try to apply it, you're denying faith. So there's this balance where you've got to, you know, if you're going to live by faith, you have to give up your intelligence. You got to be stupid. God is not stupid. He's not called us to be stupid. He's not called us to be ignorant. As a matter of fact, He says that we are to study to show ourselves approved. A workman that does not need be ashamed. Okay? Rightly divining the word of truth. Okay? We don't give up our intelligence when we become Christians. As a matter of fact, I have found that intelligence has been a huge block to a lot of people becoming Christians. For two reasons. One, because we've given up our intelligence and we go to them and say, be like us. And intelligent people don't want to be like us. And two, because if they can't figure it out, how can they follow it? God is beyond our understanding, but that is not a reason or an excuse for us to be foolish. Oh, I'm just taking everything by faith. You realize you just spent your entire month's salary on 2 5-gallon buckets of ice cream. Oh, I'm just going to live by faith. That's a true story, by the way. Come and talk to me afterwards. I'll tell you about 10 gallons of Baskin-Robbins ice cream. No. God expects us to be as shrewd as serpents, and yet to be free of guile, to be as innocent as doves. Okay? We use the application of the intelligence, the wisdom, the insight that God has given us. A lot of that being handed down by those that went before us. Any fool can learn from experience. But it takes a wise person to learn from somebody else's experience. So if we're really smart, we're going to start talking to those that came before us and learned not to do. And we're going to start paying attention. You know, it's not really wise to go about it this way, and this is why. It's why I am so appreciative of our Golden Girls and some of the older men in this church, that they speak wisdom to us. But we got to listen. We got to open our ears and hear. One thing I want to say today that I've noticed for several years, it blesses my heart to look around this congregation and to see the number of men that are here without wives. Every church I go to, the wives will come without their husbands. But for a husband to come without his wife, or a husband to come that doesn't have a wife, that's dedication and devotion to God. So I want to say to you men that are here without your wives today, God commends you. God commends you. And I think that speaks very well of the men in our church. Father, we bless you today. We thank you that you are full of grace and mercy. Father, that you are ever present. Your love never fails. You never leave us. You never forsake us. And even when you're quiet, you are standing there ready to catch us when we fall. We bless you today, Father, for your word. We bless you for your spirit that gives us insight and understanding. We thank you for your son. In Jesus' name, amen.